If we just adjust it correctly, it'll still rest. Yeah, I think it was probably tighten and then pull.
Gyanti Mirandasya Gyanajana Salakaya Chaksi Unlimitam Yena Tasmani Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stakitam Yena Bhutala Swayam Rupa Kadam Mayam Dadati Sva Padantikam Bandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavamscha Si rupam sagrajatam sahagana raganatam vitam tam sujivam sadvaitam sarvadutam parijana sahitam krishna chaitanya devam Sri Radha Krishna padam sahagana lalita Sri Vishakam vitamscha Hey Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radhakanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Rahe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishavaru Suti Devi Pranamami Hari Kriye Vansha Kaupa Taru Vrishcha Kripa Sindhu Pahe Vrishcha Patitana Bhagadevyo Vaishnavevyo Namaho Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Sivasari Gaur Bhaktivinoda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya, Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale, Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine, Namaste Saraswati Deve, Gaudavani Pacharine, Nira Srisa Sunyavadi Pastyaktya Deva Satarini, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. The beauty of chanting the glories of the holy name by devotees who have a taste for the holy name is that whoever's in that area gets to taste also. It really doesn't matter what level of spiritual practice you're on. In fact, even if you're not even practicing, the holy name chanted by those who have that taste for chanting. In other words, those who are developed a mood of bhakti through the mood of chanting the holy names can change the whole world. And we become like a sponge. We just absorb that transcendental sound vibration and enters into our ears, and goes into the heart, and then all of a sudden the mind starts to become happy and the legs start to move. The hands start to clap. And then after that, it's indescribable what may happen. All kinds of things. Now this is Krishna's holy name, chanted by those who have that taste. So our seminar continues on the Shikshastakam prayers. And yesterday, I wasn't able to finish the third verse on the Shikshastakam, so I'll just speak a little bit on that, and then today's class is on the fourth verse. As we were mentioning, the process of bhakti is in 9 stages. Adhastrata, faith, association with devotees, taking shelter of a spiritual master and becoming initiated. Fourth stage is anartha nivritti, working on getting rid of the anarthas. Fifth stage is that one, when one becomes free from 75% of one's anarthas, then one reaches the stage of nishta, which is steadiness in the practice of devotional service. The anarthas doesn't allow us to stay steady, but when we be able to somehow remove some significant parts of our anarthas, according to Bhakti Rahasya by Bhakti Vinod Thakur explains that when 75% of the anarthas are eliminated, then one can reach the stage of ruchi. Or I'm sorry, nishta. On that stage, one develops what we say a constant practice in the execution of devotional service and cultivates the third verse in the process of devotional service. To remain steady, one cannot do that unless they do two things. Freed from 75% of their anarthas, and basically the essence of that freedom is that one should consciously give up the desire to enjoy sense gratification. The tendency still may be there, and one may fall back to that activity due to association or due to that tendency still being there within the heart, but one should consciously try to eliminate these activities which are contrary to our spiritual progress. In other words, sense gratification, material sense gratification. And the other thing is that one will constantly practice the third verse. Practice humility, practice tolerance, practice giving respect and honor to others, and practice not wanting the desire for one's own glorification, respect, honor. Although it may come, one should not be enthusiastic to receive it, nor should one look for opportunities to do things in order to get some kind of honor, or what we say, distinction. In other words, a devotee is humble. As we heard yesterday from Buddha Bhavana Prabhu, how much that quality of humility is foundational to everything that we do in devotional service. So humility is a constant cultivation of that mood, and we describe the different forms of humility. Tolerance allows us to continue on despite difficulties and reverses in our practice. Pridelessness, which is the element that covers both respect for others and not wanting respect for oneself, means that one will see within the hearts of all other living entities Krishna's there. When we actually pay our obeisances to devotees, we're actually paying our obeisances to the Lord within the heart of that devotee. That is the actual, what we say, understanding of the complete mood of obeisances. Not only, there's two souls in the heart of every living being, Krishna and that person, that living entity. So generally, when we honor through the mood of respect by offering obeisances to a person, we're actually honoring Krishna in the heart of that devotee. So therefore, a humble devotee has no problem giving respect to others because they see Krishna in the heart, or they have that understanding that Krishna is in the heart of every living entity. And not wanting respect for oneself, this takes some practice, but it can only really develop when we get somewhat of a taste for our practice of Krishna consciousness. When that taste, that sweet taste of Krishna consciousness is not there, we may look for some kind of material fortification in order to fill that gap within our life. And so we may want respect, we may want some kind of material benefit. But it's just trying to fill the void. Therefore, when the void is filled with devotion and happiness that comes by way of devotion, one thinks, well, this other stuff is useless. There's a sweet taste that comes. So through the practice of that mood of devotion, not asking for respect for oneself, and not always giving respect to others, one can move forward to the next stage. And that is what is called ruchi, the stage of ruchi. And that's the fourth verse. Each of these verses in the Chaitanya Shikshastakam, it corresponds with a particular level of spiritual development. So the third verse is nishta, and the fourth verse is ruchi. So on that platform, this results from humility in devotional service, one gets to the chance to actually reach that stage. Love increases, and this is a very sweet stage. What is that? Brahma Bhuta Prasannatma Nasochati Nakankshati Samasarveshu Bhuteshu Mad Bhakti Lavate Prama. And Krishna explains this verse in the Bhagavad Gita in the 18th chapter, Prasannatma, that the soul, Atma, is Prashanta, happy, joyful. And what is that? Nasochati Nakankshati. Doesn't hanker for anything. Doesn't lament if something is lost or something is not gained. These are characteristics of that fourth verse. One is fixed in one's devotional service and is happy. Ruchi stage is a transformation of our emotions in devotional service, and the heart starts to become soft. Some of the characteristics: that person is naturally pleasing to everyone, attracts everyone's affection, possesses all good qualities, pleasing, popular, qualified, and happy. So you see, many times we see devotees who have that mood. It's an internal mood that comes by way of their growth in devotional service, and it's not simply sporadic. We, on any stage, we can have these symptoms and express those symptoms that are, what we say, described in this fourth verse. But then again, because it's not steady, it's not actually on that stage. So when one becomes fixed on that stage, that stage is... So Lord Chaitanya, he chants that verse, or he actually created that verse, and he also chants it. And what is that? Nadanam na janam na sundarim kavitam va jagadisha kamviye manma janmani janmani ishvare bhavatad bhakti ahoy tuki tuayi. Now, he's not saying this from a theoretical platform. Like, theoretically, we might say, well, I don't want all these things. But then again, when situations change, that theoretical development is not really factual. In other words, we haven't developed it in realization. So he's saying, I don't want wealth. What is wealth? Wealth is an opportunity to control and enjoy in this world. Everyone seeks wealth, because if you get wealth, you get followers. You get followers, you can also have the pleasures of the opposite sex. Wealth also attracts that. So wealth, everyone is chasing after wealth in some form or another, or those who aspire for material success. They're all looking for, as Prabhupada would say, money is the honey. But then again, there's bees around the honey. So, Hare Krishna. And sometimes it's not just one bee either. It's a hive. So yeah, money is not simply coming in one way. It comes with so many problems. And that's mentioned in the 11th canto, that there are 15 bad qualities that follow wealth. 15. Enmity, enmity, anger, oh, so many. This is in the pastime with Avanti Brahmana. He was so wealthy, but he was such a terrible person. Nobody liked him. But they used to hang around him because he was very, very wealthy. And he, at one point, and he would use and abuse people and his relatives, family members. They also had that same connection with him. They liked his wealth more than they liked him. But then, providence changed things around. And what happened? All his wealth was lost. And everybody around him was gone. Nobody liked him anymore, and not only that, they criticized him, they abused him, they did so many things to him. But somehow or other, he was able to see the futility of material enjoyment, and a type of peace entered into his heart when he actually understood that now I don't have any problems. And then he was able to take shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and became a great devotee. But in that transition stage, he was being abused, and he was being ridiculed. He was even, people were doing all kinds of stuff to him, physically and verbally. But he remained, what we say, dhira. He wasn't disturbed by these things. Why? Because he found within his heart a type of peace that came with freedom from the anxiety of having material things and trying to enjoy those. So nadanam, Lord Chaitanya says, I don't want wealth. Nadjanam, I don't want followers. When people like to have other people following them, right? Become famous, have followers, become popular, to praise, to be glorified, to be praised, to be honored, to see yourself as important in the lives of others, that is an intoxication. Whoa! It's called pratishta. But you know what bhakti? Siddhanta.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna.
That was a musical interlude. Now, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati gives a very, poignant, I guess that's the word, description of material thing. He doesn't give it a very nice description. He calls material fame, or the desire for material fame, the stool of a boar. I mean, you can't get much lower than that. So it's not, and what is he saying? That it's actually a source of great misery. But people chase for material fame, and followers are indication of one who's famous. If one doesn't have any followers, there's no question of fame. So Lord Chaitanya says, I don't want wealth, I don't want the followers, I don't want the pleasure of having followers. And it's now Sundarim. Sundarim means two things, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati and Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur both come up with a second definition for Sundarim. Sundarim generally means, in the definition that we are familiar with, I don't want the pleasures of the opposite sex. It doesn't say association, it says those pleasures that come by that association. In other words, in this material world, everyone is moved by that attraction. And this attraction, as Prabhupada said, boy attracted to girl, girl attracted to boy, is natural. He says you don't have to learn it. It is automatically there within the nature of human existence. And where does it come from? It comes from Krishna. And Krishna is naturally attracted to the gopis, and the gopis are attracted to him. So that element of attraction to the opposite sex, of course in the spiritual world, it's a whole different mood, and the inebrities that are involved with that attraction are absent. It's pure spiritual love. But on this level, it's a desire to enjoy the senses, the mind, and facilities that come with that association. In this world, it seems like it's actually a need. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not smashing household life. That's not the idea. But the material conception of the attraction, which brings about a certain element of satisfaction and happiness, is what Lord Chaitanya is speaking about. He's speaking about that so-called attraction and the happiness that comes with that sense enjoyment through that attraction. So he says, I don't want that. So he goes through three things. I don't want wealth. Everybody wants wealth. I don't want followers. There are people who don't even want wealth, but they'd rather have followers. In this world, people are, if they can become famous, they'll do anything. And in fact, they'll do the most ridiculous things just to become famous or get attention. In Kali Yuga, we see how what goes on is what we say standard activity. Like one man, he wanted to become famous, so he decided to eat a whole car. Everything in the car, the metal, the rubber, the plastic. This is the discussion between Prabhupada and Tamal Krishna Goswami. Tamal Krishna Goswami is speaking to this to Prabhupada. Prabhupada's listening. One man, he took a car and grounded it down to his finest particles he could, and every day he ate a little bit of that car until he finished the whole car. So next life, he takes birth as a car. Or maybe a roach with inside of a car. So this is how ridiculous, you know, the desire for fame can get. This is, we all laugh, but for that person, he made it a serious endeavor in his life. Why? I ate a car. I'm famous. I mean, what benefit do you get out of eating a car? Nothing. But the fame that comes from that is what he was after. I mean, people will risk their lives to become famous, right? So Lord Chaitanya says, forget it. I don't have any attraction for these things. I don't have any attraction for wealth and all the benefits it can bring. I don't even want the pleasures of the opposite sex. Now, the fourth part, or actually the third part, the second half of the third one, is that I don't even want to be known as a great scholar of Vedic knowledge. That's also Sundarim by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. That when a person becomes involved in spiritual life, they may study the Vedas, and they may also have good intelligence where they can recite the Vedas very nicely, and speak and attract the minds of others. And there's this type of fame that comes with that, or type of attraction that is there. And Prabhupada says, if a person is ugly, they are not very attractive. So, but they'll become a learned scholar, and therefore they become beautiful, even though physically they have no beauty. And this is an element of how the mind works. Just by becoming knowledgeable, that attracts people. So, and even in spiritual circles, people are interested more in learning, reciting, and knowing, and more than in the actual process of bhakti, where it's the humble submission of the heart and engaging in devotional service. So there's a kind of a taste for that prestige that comes by way of having knowledge. We might say, to give it some element of credibility, it's a bhakta who's motivated by jnana. More like jnana bhakta, mixed, but more jnana is more important than the bhakti. So, and Lord Chaitanya says, I don't want that either. And then he goes on to say something that is really astounding. I don't even want liberation. In fact, I'm not even aspiring to go back home, back to Godhead. I'm aspiring simply to become your devotee, Janmani Janmani Ishwari. What is he saying? Life after life after life. Why? Because if I'm your devotee, it doesn't matter where I am or what is my service to you. And because I'm your devotee, I'm happy and my life is perfect. When Lord Chaitanya was giving out benedictions to the devotees in the Mahaprakash Lila, he asked Srila Haridas Thakur, Haridas, please take a benediction. Anything you want, please ask. Haridas said, I'm happy. The Lord was insistent, and he was in the mood of wanting to give, and he wasn't taking anyone's refusal. Take something from me. So finally Haridas said, all right, in any birth I take, life after life, simply let me be born in the home of your devotees so I can eat the remnants of their prasadam. Even if I'm a dog in their house, if I can get the remnants of their prasadam, that is what I aspire for. Because he's tasting such happiness, in his service to the Lord and in glorifying the Lord by chanting. So he's not asking for anything other than to be connected with the Lord life after life. So this stage is a high stage. This is the stage of Ruchi. And one does not aspire for anything material, not even liberation. Janmani, Janmani, Ishwari, Bhavata, Bhakti, Ahai, Tukhi. Just give me your devotional service life after life. So this is a very high stage of spiritual practice. It's not something small. So, but it's only the fourth stage. No, fifth stage. It's the fifth stage out of nine. And what are some of the symptoms of this stage? There's this thing called excellence of elements and without excellence of elements. This is interesting. When we go to a kirtan, you know, we really, many of us, of course, maybe can say most of us, are inspired by the beautiful singing and the melodious orchestration. When the mridangas are playing nicely and everything is together, it's all very... And then the voice is there and it just lifts you right up. That's called excellence of elements. All the elements are there in the expression of the bhakti. It mostly pertains to kirtan. It can also pertain to worship of the Lord as the deity. But then there's another element, it's called without excellence of elements, where it doesn't matter who's singing or what is the orchestration, because it's a glorification of the Lord, the person is enjoying that kirtan or feeling happy in that. I mean, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati, he couldn't sing. As one of his, I mean, he had so many outstanding spiritual qualities, but when he would sing, it was completely off key. But because he sang with such devotion, still, you know, he was attractive in that way. But to appreciate that level of devotional service means that it doesn't matter, because it's the glorification of the Lord, it is attractive. So within the stage of Ruchi, there's two stages. One is higher than the other. That when all the elements are there, when everything is nicely arranged, then the bhakti that it comes from that inspires me to higher levels of happiness and joy, ecstasy. But when the bhakti, when that element is not there, I don't feel the same thing. Although there may be something like that. So there's two levels like that. But Srila Prabhupada, now just to divert a little bit, Srila Prabhupada in his preaching, he wanted the devotees to sing nicely and have nice orchestration. He wanted that. Why? Because he said, we are trying to attract the Western mentality, and they require that. I mean, you go to kirtans in India sometimes, they're banging the drum, the gong so loud you're ready to run out the door. That's usually what happens, something falls in the middle of the... You know, bong, 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 and bang. But everybody's enjoying the kirtan. Nobody thought that that wasn't really what we should present in the Western societies, because he knew people wouldn't be so much attracted. So Prabhupada was very precise in organizing kirtans in such a way that everything was done nicely. If somebody couldn't play the kartals, Prabhupada would say, give it to him. One time Prabhupada was ready to lead a bhajan, and one devotee was all ready, he was all fired up to sing with, you know, play for Prabhupada. Prabhupada said, give it to him. Because he could play better. You know. So Prabhupada was very, very, what we say, what's the word, concerned that the kirtans were very nicely orchestrated. Why? For two reasons. Not only for the attraction for the Western mentality, but he wanted the glorification of the Lord to be done in the best possible way. That was the main reason. The Lord should have the nicest, everything should be nice for the Lord, like that. I mean, many times Prabhupada would stop someone who couldn't sing, or stop someone who couldn't play the mridangas or kartals or something like that. It was many of his, and then many of his leaders also were trained in the same way. I remember I was at one kirtan, I was playing, I couldn't play the kartals. The person said, "Stop playing!" Okay. So we want that, both for the glorification of the Lord, or what we say, the pleasure of the Lord. As Prabhupada said, everything should be done as nicely as it can for the Lord's pleasure, and also for attracting the minds and attention of the Western mentality generally. But there is this element that's mentioned here. When these things are not there, and there's some singing is going on, or some program is going on, and it's not so nicely done, but because it's done with bhakti, there's an attraction. The element of bhakti makes the attraction, the whole thing. So there is that level of taste that comes by way without precision, excellence of elements. That's a stage of ruchi also, like that. So this is the beginning, or starting to develop the stage of higher levels of bhakti, where bhava bhakti is beginning to manifest. So ruchi is very sweet like that. There's many more things that are symptomized by this particular stage. But we can stop and see if there's any questions. Any questions on Nadanam Najanam? Yes, Paroksha? Should be adjustment. Lord Chaitanya, it says, Prabhupada also talks, sometimes he would say, Lord Chaitanya did kirtan without instruments. Many times. They just clapped and they sang. Because actually the voices are the most important thing. There's a thing called alankara, which means, in one sense, means embellishments. The musical part of the kirtan is supposed to enhance and heighten the bhakti that is being sung, and not to take away from it. If it takes away from it, then it's self-defeating, obviously. So Krishna is not so much attracted by, nice orchestration, but by the bhakti. And when a nice orchestration is there, it makes bhakti even more attractive. Let me give you an example, I guess. Let me think how the... I just had the example and I forgot it. Prabhupada says, when you have zeros, you can have 100 zeros and all you have is zero. But when you put a one in front of the zeros, each of the zeros multiplies the number by 10, to the power of 10. So the one is the devotion. And so when the musical accompaniment enhances the singing nicely, it's like adding zeros to the one, which increases the number like that. And that's my understanding. But the most important thing is the singing, obviously. We are not what we say, what do we call it? Just instrumentalists, where we use instrumentalum for embellishments. Like sometimes during the kirtan, we'll stop the singing, and then the flute will play, or that's nice. It enhances the mood, but then it builds the mood in such a way that when the voice comes back in, it's an heightened experience like that. It's helping to embellish the sweetness of the chanting, or make the chanting even more and more wonderful. Just like if you have a flower, and that's nice, but if you put the flower in a vase and you put nice shrubs around it and you put other flowers to enhance the main flower, then it's even more attractive like that. The flower's attractive in itself, but when there's an enhancement, it makes it. A bouquet is more attractive than just a flower. But the most important part is the glorification of the Lord through the voice. Yeah. But to leave the kirtan because it's not there, I would say, you know, we could also make some adjustments. The instruments should not drown out the voice. Yes, Buddha?
I have two questions. Oh, first one is, so in terms of how something external may enhance the devotion, because you're talking about the example of the bouquet and so on, does that mean that the effect of that overall offering, is it purely dependent upon the devotion, is it dependent upon the externals in terms of how they enhance, is it everything together? In other words, what determines the effect of a service?
Well, the Krishna is pleased or not. Krishna is pleased by bhakti. Krishna is pleased by Prabhupada. I was listening to Prabhupada this morning. Queen Kunti is offering a nice prayer to Prabhupada, to Krishna. And Prabhupada was saying, and Krishna is smiling. That's actually in the verse too. By her prayer, she caused Krishna to smile. And then Prabhupada went on to say that her prayers were so much encased in pure love and arranged in such a beautiful way that the expression enhanced the beauty of the words she was offering. Krishna smiled. But then Prabhupada went on to explain that even if the expression is not perfect, but the bhakti is there, Krishna will still smile. In other words, he's interested in hearing about the bhakti. The bhakti was what really attracts him.
So related to that, in terms of our glorification of Srila Prabhupada, sometimes we'll glorify the fact that Prabhupada was able to, you know, bring so many people towards Krishna, open so many temples and so on. Is there a way of distinguishing, is it the case that when someone offers some service, is there a devotional aspect to it and also an external aspect? In other words, is it possible that someone's service can also be, the result can be due to their karma?
I don't think you can separate that.
Okay.
Yeah. Prabhupada said you can't separate a person from its potency. If you take its potency away, there's not much left to the person. So Prabhupada's potency is glorifiable too, because it's coming from him. It's just like we say, there's no difference between the potent and the potency. But there is a difference, but then in the same sense, without the potent, there's no potency. So if you just want to remove the potency and say it's not glorifiable, no. They're both together. We say the name, fame, form, activities of the Lord are absolute. Same with his pure devotee. So when you glorify his activities, you're glorifying him. Is that okay?
Yes.
That's the answer? Okay. Yes, Maria?
Sometimes you start to do some service. And at the beginning you want to please Krishna and the spiritual master. And then you understand that now you enjoy the service.
Now you can?
What?
Now you understand?
That I enjoy the service myself.
Good. That's good. You should enjoy it. I remember in the old days we would think, we would be like, why are you looking like that? We're not supposed to enjoy it. Prabhupada didn't like that. Krishna consciousness is enjoyable. But the idea is who are you putting first, yourself or Krishna? When you put Krishna first, because you're connected with Krishna, you're gonna, if he's happy, you're gonna be happy. And I was listening, in the same lecture I was listening this morning, Prabhupada said, when Krishna is pleased, the whole world benefits. He says, everyone gets the benefit when Krishna smiles. Everybody, no matter who they are, devotee or whatever. But yeah, so if you're trying to please Krishna, and you make that effort, because in trying to please Krishna is just as good as pleasing Krishna. Because the mood of wanting to please Krishna is absolute. So I want to please Krishna. I may not know exactly the best way, but that's my desire. And therefore, Krishna is pleased by your sincere effort. So if you're happy because of that, good. If you're not happy, then that's a problem. But you should not try to enjoy, you should try to serve. A devotee is not thinking, I'm going to enjoy by doing this service. A devotee doesn't think that. A devotee just wants to do the service. The service is what is enjoyable. On the highest level, even if you don't enjoy, you enjoy because it's service. The example is Srimati Radharani on the highest level. She wants to be with Krishna, but Krishna wants to be with another gopi. So she's the only one that knows really how to please Krishna perfectly. So she'll go to that gopi that Krishna wants to be with, and she'll instruct that gopi how to please Krishna nicely. And then when that gopi goes with Krishna, she's happy because Krishna's getting the best, getting nice, what we say, devotion. And she helps to bring that about. But we might say she's sacrificing herself to be with Krishna so that Krishna can be pleased by being with that other gopi. So what is that? That means the mood of wanting to please Krishna on the higher levels is that if your happiness is my sadness, then my sadness is your happiness. You got that? That's a higher level. If I'm miserable and my misery is causing you happiness, my dear Lord, that's my happiness. But that's the higher level. But still, the idea is that we don't look for our own happiness. We look for service, that's all. That's all. We simply try to serve. And we try to serve in such a way that is pleasing for others. If we get happiness from that, wonderful. If we don't, we don't give up our service. See, this is called neophyte. Neophyte means it's about me. I'm serving Krishna to get what I can get something from it. You are. You're getting a chance to serve. That's the whole point. So we don't care whether we get some pleasure or not. We want to simply give pleasure to Krishna or Krishna's devotees. That's our mood. That's bhakti. That's all. And if you, when we develop that mood, you're always happy because you don't look for nothing. You just, you know, you're satisfied simply by the opportunity to serve. That's all. And if you get happiness, great. And usually Krishna reciprocates like that.
Hmm? But it's scary to feel this happiness because...
What is it? It's some there's a sense of satisfaction that comes by offering that service. When you do something, sometimes you feel like you don't feel kind of satisfied. There's something missing. Well, when you reflect back, well, why am I, you know, why am I feeling like this? Well, maybe because I didn't really put my heart into it. I just tried to get it done. Or somehow or other, Krishna was not pleased. Maybe I had some pride, and because I offered the service with in the mood of being proud, because I might have so many talents and I might use, you know, like sometimes a person may have a lot of ability and they think, oh, I'm going to serve Krishna so nicely. But Krishna doesn't care about your abilities. he's the source of those abilities. So sometimes a person will feel a little empty after the service because there's some element of it's about me. As long as we still have that mood, it's about me, you won't find the complete satisfaction you get from the service. You may get something, but not what you could actually experience when it's done simply as an offering. Even if it's not done with love, of course, we want to serve with love. That's perfection. But if it's done simply to please the person, just like you see somebody and you know they like something, and you find that item and you give it to them and they're pleased. Not because you're offering it with love, you just want to make that person happy by giving them something that they like. And then you feel satisfied because of that, because they're happy. That's bhakti. But if it's about me, then that's a stage we have to move away from. We start on that level, but gradually we have to get out of that consciousness. It's not about me, in the sense that I am part of the whole thing, but how am I part of it when Krishna's pleased? When I serve to fulfill the desires of my spiritual master, when I serve to make the other devotees happy or do something like that. So the answer is take pleasure in the service, that's all. And how you can do that, try to make the service better and better each time. Always look for ways to perfect your service. And as you perfect it, you more and more want to add that mood of bhakti, or love. Krishna, please accept this. I know it's not very much, but this is what I can offer you. That's love. Okay? Is it all right? Okay. Thank you. Sri Devi? There's 16 anarthas that's mentioned in Bhajana Rahasyam and also Madhurya Kandambini. There's 4 anarthas that come by way of bhakti, 4 anarthas that come by way of sinful activities, 4 anarthas that come by way of pious activities, and 4 anarthas that come away by way of offenses. And the offenses are the more difficult ones to get through. They usually carry on even beyond the stage of ruchi. Offenses can carry all the way up to the stage of prema. Yeah, and you can even if you're on the preliminary stage of prema, you can commit an offense. It says the only time you can become free from offenses is when you see Krishna face to face. The tendency is still there. Generally you won't, but it's possible. So what are those anarthas? Ignorance about one's own identity, ignorance about Krishna's identity, ignorance about the process of sadhana and prema bhakti, and ignorance about things that are not devotional but still I accept them as devotional, like Mayavadi philosophy and impersonalist tendencies. The four sinful activities are engaging in things that are cannot be used in Krishna's service. In other words, just useless material sense gratification. Envy, deceit and fault finding, and pratishta, fame. These are the four sinful activities. The four pious activities that are anarthas, desire for heavenly planets, desire for liberation, desire for mystic power, desire for to enjoy material sense gratification, even authorized forms of sense gratification. And the offenses are offenses to the Lord in his deity form, offenses to the Lord in his holy name, offenses to Vaishnavas, and offenses to people in general. So these are the 16 anarthas. And there's a whole gradation of how one can remove anarthas on different stages of practice. So one should be conscious of the anarthas and try to free oneself from that. Yes, Uta Baba? Oh, I thought you had a question. Okay. Another question? Anyone? Yes, Bhavesh Prabhu?
Maharaji said that we should try to do our service out of love, but at least to do it to please the other person.
Yeah.
What's the difference between please and doing it out of love?
There is an element of affection in pleasing. In other words, pleasing me, you might do something that people like, and they become pleased by that. But love is actually a desire that comes from the heart, that one actually shows some that emotion. In other words, it's coming from the heart rather than from the mind, or from personal desire. There's an affection towards the object. I mean, we can distribute books to people in general, but we may not have love for them. But it's done in a way to benefit them. So that's pleasing devotional service. But for Krishna and Krishna's devotees, love should be there. One should learn to love the devotees and love Krishna first. Because these objects are lovable, and they're natural. There's a natural loving mood that makes that relationship complete. You can't love Krishna completely unless you learn how to work with and develop what we say, genuine affection for devotees. Genuine affection means to work in such a way that you're always the well-wisher of everyone. That's pretty much a definition of affection. And of course, intimacy may be more or less accordingly to the relationship with that person. But how can you be in a family and not like the family members? Then the family that's not so good. I mean, there's some elements in the family that are not up to the standard, but that doesn't mean you reject them. It means that at the same time you can't have a loving relationship with them. But at the same time, because they're family members, you're always thinking how to help them in one way or another. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Question over this way? I thought I saw some. No? Okay. Still, we have a little more time yet. Yes. Michelle?
Or they have no desire for reading.
how to give people Vedic scriptures or Prabhupada's books? A particular type of people you're talking about? Or just people in general?
These people, family members, or some friends, or the people.
Oh, in other words, trying to encourage people, family members, to read the books. Is that it? Try different things, see what works. Practical. The more you read, and the more you speak about what you read, maybe an element to inspire others. What you're fired up about becomes more easy to communicate with others when you're not so fired up about it. The more you know the books, the more you're inspired by reading Prabhupada's books and making advancement through that reading, how much effect you'll have with others. But if you don't do it yourself, and you just say, you should read the books, then there's no potency in what you say. Is that okay? So, yeah. Be an example for what you want to communicate. We have to. We have to work on, you know, there's two things. There is what we say, precept and example. Precept is, example is higher than precept. Precept means what I say. Example is what I'm about. And if you're, what you say is what you're about, how much those words have effect. But actually, if you have to accept one or the other, example is better than precept. That's a Vedic sutra. And that's from the Vedas. You know that, the Sanskrit for that? Prabhupada would say that example is higher than precept. Precept means philosophy. So we want both, obviously. Yes?
Maharaj, you were mentioning, even in before classes and today you were mentioning about recognition. How to glorify devotees properly, according to different stages and also, especially for the neophytes, who may get
How to
up.
Glorify devotees properly? Well, I think to appreciate the association of devotees is a form of glorification. But as Buddha Bhavana mentioned yesterday, and he mentioned it many times, the importance of practicing the six exchanges of love. This is one way to glorify and to develop relationships with devotees, to give prasadam, to receive prasadam, to speak confidential knowledge, which means if I learn something about Krishna, if I have I heard a particular pastime or a philosophical precept, then I can speak that. I know certain devotees, when you're with them, they'll just talk about what they read, Krishna. And it's really nice. Usually we sit around and we talk about, hello, how are you? Well, I'm fine. You sure? You don't look so good. Well, no, I'm okay. How's the kids? They're all right. Going to school. And we get into all these mundane things. It's all right at the beginning when you want to introduce a relationship. You kind of like sort of appreciate what that other person's life's about in a very mundane way. But you want to get beyond that. If you just keep doing that, and then, you know, it goes nowhere. And you get bored. And Prabhupada would be very friendly, even in like that, hello, how are you, how's your health, like that. Okay. But if you make that the subject matter, then it gets old. There's no... So we want to talk about something spiritual, something philosophical. or something that is beneficial.
Thank you. Can I ask?
Speaking confidential knowledge, hearing confidential, giving gifts. There's one lady, she's in Denver, Colorado, and her name is, she's my god sister, Mother Nidra. She just carries books and prasadam everywhere all day, and when she meets somebody, she gives a little mahaprasad, and then she'll also try to give books. She's always giving gifts to devotees, all the time. All the time, she does this practically all day. She's a book distributor, but at the same time, she gives prasadam to devotees when she sees them. Little maha. She does pujari work, so she gets the maha. So her mood is just to give gifts to devotees through books or through... When she sees new people come into the Sunday feast, she'll run around looking for the new people and give them a free book and a little bit of maha. And she's absorbed in it. It's not like, oh, she's been doing it like for... She's been in the movement since 1972. So these are nice ways to appreciate the devotees, to give gifts, speak confidential knowledge, give prasadam, speak Krishna consciousness. Take a personal concern in the lives of other devotees. And if somebody does something outstanding, we also say, well done. I mean, when the cowherd boys would see Krishna kill a demon, well done, well done. They'd shower, demigods would shower flowers, and Krishna would be there, smiling. Well, the cowherd boys would praise Krishna's activities. So to praise a devotee is nice, and it's a nice way to honor devotees, but if it becomes pretentious and you praise for the sake of praising, then it gets, there's nothing.
It gets like sense enjoyment.
There's called professional praisers. Yeah. They're actually called, what do they call them? They're actually part of the Vedic society. Eulogizers, and they come at a very prestigious event, and they'll speak the glories of people through the whole time. They'll make poetry, they'll make songs, and they'll do everything like that.
Mandir is the word you
said. Huh?
Mandir. In Prithu Maharaj's episode, there are people who glorify.
Yeah, professional. Yeah. Yeah, professional praisers. So unless you have that position, wouldn't make it a program. It's not recommended. So, you got the idea? We relate to devotees accordingly. I don't want to put myself on any kind of special... But I walked into the temple this morning and I saw one of the organizers for the 50-hour kirtan, and she looked really tired. And I said, "You look really tired." She said, "Yeah, we'll get the rest on Tuesday. We got too much work to do." They're working really hard to keep this program going. So I was thinking, what can I do? So I had some maha. So I gave her some maha. I said, "Here, this will give you a boost." So sometimes you can see what a devotee needs and you can just kind of like, okay, let me offer something. The way to associate with devotees, the way to develop relationship with devotees, to better. But it's always for them, it's not about yourself. See, material society has polluted the consciousness of the living entity to think it's about me. And it's so strong in material. Well, that's the material world. Everyone's thinking, I am number one. And if I can get fulfill my desires and please myself, that is life, that's success. If you're part of pleasing me, then I can, you know, I also like you. But it's completely reversed. The nature of the living entity is to serve with love. That's where our position is. And when we do that, we experience our own innate, you know, natural qualities. It's, even in material societies, when you have someone who is outstanding and wanting to serve others, you find that they have wonderful qualities. Although it's misdirected, there's still that element of wanting to please others. So that's our nature. And we can't find any, we won't find happiness if we're always focusing on ourselves. We focus on ourselves by focusing on Krishna, which is the self of all self. Of course, we have to take time to rest. We have to eat. So these things, we make some arrangements for these things. We also need, you know, some place to live. So we make these arrangements. But these are basic. But as far as our happiness is concerned and the activities we perform, that's done through service. Does that make sense?
Yeah,
am I being too...
No, it's very nice inspiration.
Is that okay? Okay, thank you. Yes, Bhakti Gamya? Kanishtha means about me, yeah. Yeah. Kanishtha means about me. And the quality of a Kanishtha is, I want to serve Krishna, I want to serve the spiritual master, but the other devotees are just a nuisance. They get in the way. That's Kanishtha. Kanishtha is there is a focus on me in relationship to Krishna and my guru, and so. But the other devotees, they're okay, but they usually get in the way. that's neophyte. And the non-devotees, they're just fools, rascals, carnies, and all kinds of other derogatory labels. But therefore, the practice of bhakti in ISKCON is on the second class platform. And then what is the second class platform? There's four qualities. Loves the Lord, gives their love to the Lord, makes friendship with the devotees, preaches to the non-devotees, and avoids the atheists. Avoids those who are, you know, outwardly against bhakti, atheist demons like that. Avoids that association strictly. So these are the four characteristics of the second class platform. So we make friends with the devotees, try to offer Krishna consciousness to others, and try to serve the Lord with devotion. That's the second class platform.
Is that how one rises from the Krishna
platform? Yeah. By practicing that. And you, Prabhupada says, on the neophyte Kanishtha platform, it's just a stage. You have to get out of there. You can't stay there. You won't make any advancement, and you won't be able to stay in Krishna consciousness unless you come to the next stage. Okay, Sri Devi.
Kanishtha corresponds to which stage of the Shikshastika
and Nabdhima
to which stage of the
Shikshastika? Well, as you go through the stages, it's more about Krishna and less about you as you make advancement. I don't have my chart with me, but each of the stages, when you first come in, it's about you. When you when you start associating. And even when you're, you know, taking initiation, it's still about you, generally. But you can become aware through knowledge and through practice. What is the proper mood like that? Because a Kanista person, or a person who in that consciousness sees himself as the center, then they see everything else either favorable or unfavorable to themselves. It's about my advancement. And Prabhupada, and not Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, there's people who approach, they say, what is it? There's a kind of sense gratification which includes the Lord. And there's a kind of sense gratification that exclusively is focused on the Lord. And this is a characteristic that a person will see, the Lord is my sense gratification. And there's another person who will think, the Lord is one of the categories by which I enjoy sense gratification. So two categories. This is Bhaktivinoda Thakur and Bhakti Loka. So Krishna is there to make me happy. And therefore, when I serve, if I'm happy, Haribo. And if I'm not happy, what went wrong? In other words, a person's enthusiasm will be increased or decreased by how much pleasure they get from their activity. If they don't get the pleasure, and they don't get some satisfaction or whatever, they lose their enthusiasm. And if it continues, after a while they start, you know, becoming less and less. It's about me. What's wrong, Krishna? Don't you realize who I am? I'm one of your parts and parcels, but I'm kind of like, you know, an important one. We make all these petitions, right? You see this, Krishna? This is my list. Can you fulfill that? At least you can do 70%. Krishna says, we'll give it to Vishnu. And Vishnu says, well, give it to Indra. And Indra says, we'll give it to Shiva. Shiva says, wife, hey Durga. Something like that. So, you know, it's like that. So, yeah, we want to get away from that mentality. Anything else? Okay, so that was the fourth verse. There's other characteristics in this fourth verse. But maybe we can go on to the fifth first. Another question? Yeah. Oh yes, Mataji.
I haven't asked this question. How to motivate devotees in their service?
How to motivate devotees in their service? Impetuses for devotional service. By giving prasad. That's in the nectar of devotion. The prasadam is an impetus for devotional service. By using your intelligence to see how this person may be inspired in their Krishna consciousness. Like that. Also, sometimes by giving a service to someone. Can you do this? Devotees like to serve. So we have services that needs to be done. We need this service done. Can you do it? The devotees like to help, so there's a way to motivate them just by giving service like that. I don't know, but when someone asks you to do something, you feel, wow, that's nice, right? Get a chance to serve, isn't it? So, you can do that. Way in the back. Yeah.
So can you compare this to engaging in devotional service according to one's natural
puna? Yeah, that could also be understood. When one is fixed in their natural propensity, in other words, accordingly, that's up to the spiritual master and to the leaders to evaluate the nature of a particular devotee and engage them in that way. The more they're engaged in that way, the more they're inspired in their service, and they will become very creative and develop their service even more and more. That's why Prabhupada wanted this Vanashram system, which is Daivi Vanashram, to serve according to your nature, but in relationship to bhakti, not separate. It's not just varna, it's varna and ashram together. It's called Daivi Vanashram, spiritual Vanashram. But we should be ready to do any service at any time. That is what the movement is about, is somehow or other be. But when you're engaged according to your nature, you will be inspired in that. You might do any service. And on the higher platform, when one reaches a higher stage of bhakti, when they're free from their anarthas, they'll do any service. It doesn't matter if it's their nature or not, because it's service to Krishna. On the neophyte platform, we may not be able to be so spontaneous because of, all right, I'll do it, but I'd rather do something else. You have to go? Oh, Mother Kalangana. Thank you. Mother Kalangana is the spiritual impetus behind all the wonderful milk sweets that we get every day. She gets up before some of the times of the time where we actually take rest. She's up early in the morning before 2 o'clock, and she's in the kitchen making sweets for Sri Sri Radha Gokuldananda, Sita Ram, Lakshman, Hanuman, and Gornetai. I think she makes some, I don't know how many you make every day, but it's a lot. And the devotees get that mercy. And people from around the world have become well aware of her Mahaprasadam that comes from Radha Gokuldananda. So it's sought after by all of us. Thank you, it's the most wonderful service. And I have brought a whole bag of your sweets to distribute to the devotees right after the class. Hare Krishna. Thank you for joining us. Okay. So, yes, Bhavesh.
Mark, when a devotee decorates the deity in the morning with flowers, for example, and dresses them, and then may not be fully happy with the way they look, is that an indication that they're doing the service for their own pleasure rather than...
No, not necessarily. No, it's just if you're trying to decorate the deities nicely and you're not satisfied, you might be more of a perfectionist. There's that one story of the Jagannath Devi in Rajpur. You know that story? You know, Rajpur in the area of Navadvip town? Jagannath's there. So there one... This was in the beginning days when the devotees first got that temple, or those devis, and began a temple. was one pujari who was putting necklaces on Lord Jagannath. So he put one necklace on, and then he put a second one on, and put a third one on, and then he put a fourth one on, and as soon as he put that one on, it fell. So he picked it up and went to put it on again, and when he put it on, it fell off again. He couldn't understand why it was falling off. So he's about to put it on again, and then he hears his voice, "Don't you understand? I don't want that." Jagannath told him, "I don't want that one." So sometimes when you decorate the deity, Krishna says, "Oh, come on, you could do better than that." I have to look nice for Radharani, so you know, come on. If you're going to be on Gopi, you're going to be in Manjari Bhav, you should do it right. Assisting Radha and Krishna in her pastimes. It's very intimate service to decorate the deities, very intimate, extremely intimate. What Prabhupada gave us is unbelievable, high of spiritual practice. Intimate association with Radha and Krishna by serving them personally on the altar, by chanting prayers that are on the level of, you know, pure devotional service. So, yeah, so sometimes there's some, not dissatisfaction, but there's something that I could have did it better. But Krishna's telling me, you know, I like your devotion, but, you know, the colors don't match. Krishna will kind of let you know. It's sweet. He's not accepting your devotion. He's just letting you know that something's there. Because when it comes to the altar, you got to be good. You can't just fool around up there. It has to be done nicely, perfectly. It's more precision along with bhakti. Yes.
Sometimes I feel that chanting appreciation is much more difficult than appreciating someone else. When somebody appreciates
you.
Yeah.
It's harder to accept that. Is that what you're saying?
Chanting it is very difficult.
Yeah, what do you do with it? Someone says, "Well done, you did a nice thing," and then you think, "What am I supposed to say now?" Somebody came up to me this morning, yesterday, and said something, and I just said, "Thank you." That was it. Say thank you.
No, I mean to say not externally. Internally, you start identifying with that appreciation. And
you start identifying?
Yeah.
Well, you pass. The mood is, the idea is to pass it on.
Yeah. So that, it's not coming very instantly.
As soon as you get the appreciation, just pass it on. Thank you, Srila Prabhupada. It's by your mercy that this devotee is recognizing it. It's by their good quality. It's their good qualities that they're seeing something good in me. If you keep it, yeah. Like sometimes we say, "All glories to Prabhupada." But actually, 90% for him and 10% for me. Not, why does he have to get all for 100%? I did it. I just only want 10%. All right, just give me 5%. Something. No, we actually think is that as soon as you think you're the doer, there's a certain element of pride that starts to manifest. And Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, you know, this is the false ego. You are one-fifth of every activity. Bhagavad Gita says there's five factors of every activity. You're one of the five. You're element of endeavor. So, someone is praising, someone pass it on. You might think, if it wasn't for all these other situations to be in place, I wouldn't have been able to do that. A lot of times we don't see what prepares us for whatever we do. And we just take the credit as I did it. Maybe some devotee said something that inspired you and helped you in your service. But you don't consider that, you just consider who did it. So when we look at everything we do, we can see that there's more than just me in the picture, a lot more. So this is a practical way to look at things. The spiritual way is just to pass it on. Sri Devi? Okay, and there's that verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam where it describes, Prabhupada makes a rhetorical statement. Some say that Krishna consciousness is very difficult, and some say that Krishna consciousness is very easy. And then he conjectures, is it easy or is it difficult? He poses the question in the purport. This is the verse is 4:8:30 in Srimad Bhagavatam. It's Narada Muni speaking to Guru Maharaj. And then he answers the question. For those who are determined, it is very easy. For those who are not determined, it is very difficult. So there's the answer. So then again, you might say, well, okay, so what does it mean to be determined? So there's certain qualifications to develop determination, and there's certain things that impede your determination. And then you have to work with those things. Determination is watered down by sense gratification. The more we engage in sense gratification, the more we become less determined in our Krishna consciousness. Determination is fortified by strong association with people who are advanced. Determination is a feature of the will. When you say, I want to do something, and I will do it, then you open up the possibilities for opportunities to make that endeavor successful. I will become Krishna conscious no matter what. And then what happens? You start seeing Krishna's mercy coming through various channels. This is a feature of life. Anyone who fixes their mind on the goal, and we have to fix our mind on the goal. Bhuta Bhavana Mahaprabhu made a beautiful statement yesterday. He says a person takes initiation, he gets connected with his spiritual master, but then he develops, or that person develops another desire. So what is that connection? The connection is practically nil. It's going in the other way. This person who now is initiated but has other desire, doesn't want to reach the goal of prema bhakti, the spiritual master is trying to bring him to prema bhakti, he wants to do something else. So the connection is becoming less and less because he doesn't have the same goal that is the actual goal of devotional service. What is the goal of devotional service? Is to love Krishna or develop your love for Krishna. There's no second goal. That's the goal. Prema Pumartha Mahan. Any other goals or intermediate goals that may lead to the ultimate goal. But one has to focus on the ultimate goal. This is important, and we should understand this. We should all want to be pure devotees. We should aspire for pure devotional service. Even if you don't make it, that's not the point. The point is you should aspire for pure devotional service. And you should think, even if I don't make it in this life, even if it takes me 50 lives, I'm going to do it. But still, the idea is, this life is the life you're working with. So you want to make it in this life. So when we should aspire for pure devotional service, nothing less. Because anything less simply means we'll come back in this material world to fulfill that desire again, life after life. And that's risky. It's risky because when you come back, you could also go back down. Doesn't mean you're going to go forward when you come back. So this is the best life to work with because this is the only one we have right now. So aspiring for pure devotional service is the only aspiration. Why? Because it's the perfection of our existence. Whether you make it or not, that's secondary question. But the aspiration is what we should keep in mind. I will develop my love for Krishna. Whatever it takes. Yes?
To do the service?
To do the service
and in this own role. And you have, how to say, to get in the mood of love, and you forget about everything else, just the service, and focus on the service, but still, maybe you hurt other people because of not knowingly. Actually, you realize it, you try to.
You shouldn't. Being sensitive to other persons is part of doing your service.
Sure.
I mean, there sometimes is that enthusiasm, I have to get the service done. And someone you may encounter is somewhat an obstacle to that. But you should, like, you can't really serve Krishna nicely if you are not really relating properly with other devotees. It just doesn't work. There's one thing that really bothers me. It happens in India only. Is that sometimes, you know, because you're of a sannyasi, you walk. And so, you know, some of these young boys, they say, "Our sannyasi's coming, get out of the way, get out of the way." They're pushing everybody out of the way. Sannyasi. And I'm thinking, you know, I'm thinking, he's offending all these other people, and just so I can walk according to his way, I should walk. You know, so I'm thinking, this is weird. So he's thinking he's serving me. But he's offending everybody else, you know. And I see that it happens a lot, even in kirtans, you know. Sometimes I'll walk into a kirtan, and somebody will be jumping up and down in the middle of the kirtan, "Sannyasi, get out of the way." Yeah, he's a fanatic. I mean, he's well-intentioned, but with no intelligence. Prabhupada said you should use your intelligence how to do things. Not that you offend everybody else so you can do the service to your spiritual master or whoever it is, you know, like that. Oh, that's so annoying. I just thought I'd mention it. It happens in India, it doesn't happen in the West, only in India. You see, Mataji's, they're like jumping out of the way, little kids are running, and people are looking, and oh yeah. I mean, people are, they're actually, you know, they move, because they think, oh, we're in the way. But the way he does it, you know, is just like really horrible. I really bothers me. Anyway, I just wanted to make that point in relationship to your question. He said, always somehow or other when you're serving the Lord, it shouldn't be at the expense of someone else's distress. You should be sensitive to the other devotees. I mean, when we preach, we say things people don't like, but that's something different. That we have to do. But it's done in a mood of uplifting and not in the mood of crushing someone. Yeah. So, does that help? Yes. Is this a public service announcement?
No.
Okay, just checking. I expected, you know, even if you wanted to make a public service announcement, it's okay.
Lunch is on its way, but this is not a public announcement.
Okay.
My question is, how does one define the devotional service, pure devotional service, and fanaticism?
Well, Prabhupada would say, devotional service is pure devotional service. So when you use the word devotional service, you're actually saying pure devotional service. When you indicate it's something else, you say karma mishra bhakta, jnana mishra bhakta, mixed service, service that is in the mood of practice, like that. So when it's not pure devotional service, the Shastras give the indication. But when they say devotional service, they really mean pure devotional service. When it's written like that. When we speak of it, we don't always mean it that way. We just say that those activities in relationship to Krishna. But then, if we have to qualify it, then we say, okay, it's not pure devotional service, but it's still devotional service. But when it's written in the books, or spoken by the pure devotees, when they say devotional service, they mean pure devotional service. Fanaticism? Was it religion without philosophy is sentimentalism or fanaticism? Fanaticism means there's no basis, no philosophical basis to the activity. It's done out of whim, or it's done out of hatred. It's done out of what we say, overzealous enthusiasm without any understanding of the activity. But when something is done with knowledge, and it's done in a very enthusiastic way, someone may say that's fanaticism, but it's not. It may look like it, but it's not. And when it's done according to the directions of the Shastras, the directions of the spiritual master, then it's not fanaticism. If it's not, then it can have that element of either sentimentalism or fanaticism. Sentimentalism means without any basis in guru, shadu, sadhu, and shastra. Sentimentalism is, okay. I think I'll do some service. Yeah, I'll go feed the pigeons. And they're living entities too. And I'll give them, pigeon prasad, or some good prasadam that pigeons like. And that's a little, well, your spiritual master may not want you to do that. So that's a little on the sentimental side. It's not wrong, but it has that element of sentiment. Your spiritual master may want you to do something else. Not acting according to guru, to guru is either fanaticism or sentimentalism. Either one, right? Is that right? Okay. Okay. Yes, Mother Kantika. That's an Artha Nivritti. Verse number two is an Artha Nivritti. Anything else? Let me see if I have anything here. I'll read some of the stuff that are more principles on the fourth verse. These are more characteristics. A sense of identity in Krishna Lila, a specific intention or goal concerning participation in the Lila, the sense that that one's practice is being accepted as Lila Seva. These are all elements that are leading up to Bhava Bhakti. Some of you call it characteristic. It serves Krishna favorably, serves in a specific service, yes, as of, and three, affectionate relationships with others. Okay, let's see some of the qualities of the fourth verse. Anything else? We got 10 minutes left. We can end here. There's no more questions. Okay, thank you very much. Shri Shikshastikam ki. Shri Prabhupada ki. Jai. Om Premananda. I think we have an announcement before. Prashadam's at 1:30 and there's a little